everyone, and welcome to Yarngasm. I'm Kristen, and this is episode 198. I am also known as Volenvine on Ravelry and Instagram, where I am most active on social media, so that's where you can follow me. And if you haven't already, please do join the Yarngasm Ravelry group, where there's lots of lively chatter, lots of conversation, and the place to be if you want to join in on any of our knit-alongs, or sew-alongs, or, you know, just general conversation. It's a really fun place to be. But welcome to new and returning viewers. I hope you enjoy the episode. This is a podcast about knitting, spinning, hand-dyeing yarn, sewing, and pretty much making all the things in Brooklyn, New York, where I live and I'm from. And I'm just, as always, super happy that you are taking some time out of your day to chat about those things with me. And I have a show for you guys. I really don't know where to begin. I feel a little bit out of practice, but I just want to say thanks to everybody for the comments and the feedback on my last episode, where I had my friend Laura on as a co-host. Laura, if you're not familiar, is the host of the Dyer's Notebook podcast and the dyer behind Jinx Yarns. If you are familiar with her, you should totally check her out. She's awesome. But we had to keep her visit under wraps for quite some time, because the whole point of her visit was to surprise our friend Maria for her baby shower. And Maria had no clue. She was totally surprised. So it was, you know, our plans were a success, which is awesome. But while she was here, we had a lot of fun. I'll talk more about that in blather, but we dyed yarn together. We just bummed around Brooklyn. I showed her the sights and we ate lots of yummy food. Again, I'll talk more about that in blather, but we had a great time. I kind of miss having a live-in knitting friend, if you will, but otherwise, we got a lot done. It's very productive. So, without further ado, I am just going to do a couple of admin announcement thingies before I get into what I've been making this week. And this is a lot of information, so I will put something in the down bar so you know where to jump ahead if you're not interested. But I do want to just mention that we are quickly coming upon the 200th episode / 6th podiversary of Yarngasm. Which is super exciting. I cannot believe that I've been podcasting for 6 years, but I've been having so much fun, so it does make sense. Time will fly, right? But I did want to find a way to thank you guys, whether you've been with me since the beginning or have just started watching. If it wasn't for you guys, I wouldn't be podcasting every week. So as a way to thank you, I have 4 prizes up for grabs. And those are, just to reiterate, and I think I've talked about them in previous podcasts, but of course, there will be 1 skein of Volenvine yarns, my hand-dyed yarns, up for grabs in a colorway of your choosing on my Volca base, which is a lovely merino nylon cashmere superwash fingering weight blend. And we also have Beyond the Vanilla Socks pattern collection from Mina Phillip, who is the lovely host of the Knitting Expat podcast. Thank you so much, Mina. And then Agata Mackiewicz has contacted me on Ravelry and generously offered me a copy of her new pattern, Brokey Lawn, which is a beautiful shawl pattern. And she also offered one for one of you viewers. So thank you so much, Agata. And then we also have where's the card? There we go. From Sew, Knit, Create. Naomi surprised me, completely surprised me in the mail. I wasn't even expecting this, but she generously sent me these 2 beautiful and very cleverly designed necklaces. So let me show it to you. And totally my colors too, because they're purple and gray. The packaging is really beautiful as well. But these really beautiful purple and mauve shaded beads. And then look at this. How awesome is that? Stitch markers. So I love it. It's a necklace and it also doubles as a utility for your knitting. So really clever. Thank you so much, Naomi. She sent one for me and one for you as well. So that will also be offered up as a prize for the giveaway. So in order to win one of those prizes, simply go over to the Yarngasm Ravelry group and in the 200th episode thread, just answer one or both of the following questions. What do you hope to see more of in the podcast? And what is your favorite Yarngasm moment? One or both of those questions will do. I'm blown away by how many comments there already are in that thread, and it's just been so wonderful reading through all of your responses and suggestions, and you guys are just You are awesome. So thank you so much for all your compliments and just even memories that I never, that totally escaped me. Like somebody had mentioned Blipgate. I don't know if any of you remember, but a lot of podcasters were uploading their podcast to BlipTV, which, you know, it was free, it was easy. And then suddenly they just cut the cord on, you know, they just filtered through all their people uploading on there, and they gave the axe to a lot of knitting podcasts, which was really unfortunate. But anyway, that was a really fun flashback that I had while reading through there. But yeah, so lots of fun memories. I love reading through them. So thank you so much, everybody. And then the other announcement that I want to make is for our sew-along. Our summer sew-along has ended, and I was a day late closing the thread. So if you were able to squeeze in a last-minute project, then awesome you, because that thread has just been so inspiring and so wonderful. You know, whether you're a new sewer or have been sewing and haven't, you know, have been wanting to get back into it, it's just been a really inspiring thread going through. I've discovered some new sewing patterns that I've never seen or heard of, and I just hope you guys have felt the same. I hope that it's been like a learning process, and you know, it's just been a really fun project, and I definitely want to do it again. But I realized I never talked about prizes for that that sew along. So I decided that I'm going to be offering up one PDF sewing pattern of your choice under $20 US. So that will be a prize offered up. And the winner is, and I used random.org like you do to choose winners, and the winner of our summer sew along, where the goal pretty much was to sew at least two garments for summer or whatever season that you're going into, because it's not summer everywhere in the world. That would just become a staple piece in your wardrobe for that season. So there were 274 participants, and random.org chose number 23, and Judith 100 has won. So yay, congrats to you. Please contact me on Ravelry and letting me know your info and which pattern you would like, and I will hook you up ASAP. But yeah, Judith created three patterns total. She sewed the Hawthorne top by Colette, the Camber dress by Merchant and Mills, and the Ultimate Wrap dress, one of my favorite patterns, by Sew Over It. So congrats, very well deserved, beautiful work, and congrats to everybody. I mean, there was a lot of beautiful garments being made in that thread, and I definitely want to do this again. So maybe for fall, we'll just revisit season two. I think I called it Summer Sew Along, or no, what was it? Project Sew Along season one. So this was season one, and we're gonna do season two come fall. Or towards the end of summer. Maybe we'll do this in August. When is the first day of fall? I don't know. I'll check the calendar, see what makes sense, and then we'll go from there. But anyway, yeah. So that said, I am going to dive into what's off my needles. So Bella has stopped by to say hello. What's up, Bella Boos? What's up? You want a podcast with me? What do you have to say today? What have you been knitting? Have you been knitting anything? I think she's pretty much just been leaving behind little dust bunnies or fluff, so thinking that I'm going to spin with it, but I don't think it's going to happen. I don't think I want to spin your fluff, babes. No, too warm. But anyway, I do have a finished object to share with you this week, and it is a hoe, or a half object. I've finished knitting one sock. When Laura came, I felt it was appropriate to cast on using some of her yarn, and this is her fifth anniversary colorway, 5 years of running Jinx yarn, so congrats, Laura! Unfortunately, it is a limited, very limited edition colorway. I think she's only making 120 of them, and she will not be having any more up for grabs until after she gets back from SSK towards the end of July, just FYI. But I was able to snag a skein, so very happy about that. And yeah, it's just a simple 1x1 ribbing cuff down vanilla sock. I did do an afterthought heel, which I will be honest, I'm not crazy about afterthought heels. I just find them a little too fiddly, but they are very aesthetically pleasing when it comes to self-striping yarns, because as you can see, like it works out, you know, because if you were to do like a regular turned heel, the stripes would just get all discombobulated and muddy and everything. So the afterthought heel is a good choice for self-striping, but so is the Fish Lips Kiss heel. That I find works very well with self-striping yarns. which I think I will be doing from now on going forward. The fish lips kiss heel is pretty much my favorite go-to heel nowadays. But yeah, I mean, the afterthought heel does have its place. So yeah, I mean, I really love the way these knit up. The colorway is just so fun, and I really love Laura's sense of color when it comes to just color in general, and even her self-striping yarns. I mean, I can't really describe it, but I just love, I love all of her self-striping yarns because it's like, they're not just solid colors, they're variegated and speckled stripes as well. So, you know, up close it looks like a paint, you know, it's like a Monet, it's like up close it looks like a painting, but from far away it's like, oh yeah, there are the stripes. So, if that makes any sense, but yeah, I love her yarns so much. So, very excited about this. This pretty much knit itself, I have to say that, but, you know, I cast on when she arrived, and then I finished the sock 2 days ago, and cast on the second sock. So, I will show you where I am with that. It's kind of like a sock beard at this point, as Candace from the Pin Feathers and Pearls podcast calls it. So I'm finished with the cuff, and now I just have to knit. It's a beard, see? Yeah, now I just have to knit the leg and then go from there. But yeah, and I'm using my Carbons, my US 1.5, 2.5 millimeter knitting needles, circulars, which are pretty much my favorites right now. So yeah, having a lot of fun with that. Here's the cake, and it's living. I don't know what this is, you guys. Every time. I feel like the last podcast, I pulled out a pair of socks and they were just in tangles. I don't know what it is with me, but anyway, it's living in my Little Creek Designs project bag from Selma of the Two Tangled Skeins podcast. And she just launched her Etsy shop, and I hear it was a huge success, which is no surprise to me because her sewing is wonderful and her sense of color and pairing fabrics together, I think, is absolutely beautiful. So definitely check it out. Congrats, Selma. Your bags are beautiful. So yay. Speaking of which, there is another project bag that she sent me, like a matching pair. And here's the other one. So yeah, this one pretty much just matches with this one. So it goes really well together. But yeah, living in this one, it's kind of not really so much a tale of woe as kind of like a WTF moment where I'm like, what was I thinking? So as you know, I had cast on the Loden shawl, a pattern designed for Brooklyn Tweed. I think I'm always blanking on the designer's name, but it's like Dmitrieva is the last name. I think it's Irina Dmitrieva. I could be wrong, down bar with all the correct info. But yes, as you know, I cast on the Loden shawl. Here it is. I haven't really made any more progress than what I showed you last time, but for a very sad explainable reason. But here it is. It's absolutely beautiful. I love working on it. It's incredibly intuitive. I've just been zipping by it, and you know, I say it's easy, and you know, granted you have to cast on a plethora of stitches. I think it was like 400 plus stitches that I had to cast on, but then it gets, you know, less and less because you start off at the bottom of the shawl. It's a triangular shawl, and then it slowly decreases to the top portion of the shawl. If that makes sense. But the reason why I have not made much progress on this is because as I was knitting this, yes, the other day, I had noticed that I had inadvertently dropped four stitches, eight rows down. Who does that? Who drops four stitches and doesn't realize it? And those four stitches are currently living on this removable stitch marker, and I have a plan for it. I do. But when I realized that, I was just like, FML. So yeah, I'm talking in acronyms because otherwise this would not be a child-friendly podcast. But yeah, so I put it on removable stitch markers, and I had to put it down. I just could not work on it anymore. Just, you know, put it aside, pour a glass of wine, watch a movie, and just put it in timeout for a little bit. But you know, after I just calmed down a little bit, I looked at it and like, okay, this, I think I can kind of salvage it without having to rip all the way back, because it is a dark pattern. I mean, it is a dark colorway. So my plan is to knit, or just kind of like crochet like knit four together, knit these four stitches together to create one stitch, and then take a crochet hook and crochet up the ladders, if that makes any sense, the eight rows, and then kind of secure it in the back of the shawl. I think that will work out nicely without it looking like a gaping mistake or anything. So stay tuned. Stay tuned for that, you know, what happens with this, but I think it can be saved, so it's not a lost cause. My heart did break a little bit, and I was like, I'm never working on this again, but I'm not giving up. I'm not giving up, guys. So yeah, but again, the yarn is the Woolen Rabbit in their singles base, and the Chocolate Chambord colorway, which, yeah, you guys, this colorway is totally... lives up to the name. It's chocolatey, chambordy, and lovely. So having fun with that. And yeah, I'm knitting. These are on clover bamboos, and I will have to, I am pretty much at the end of the row, so I think I'm gonna swap these out for my metal chiagus. And the reason why I have these on bamboo is because I took this away on vacation with me. So, you know, going through TSA, you know, I just didn't want to freak out the TSA with metal needles. Although I did receive a couple of comments saying that the TSA doesn't worry about that now. They don't have problems. I would, like, you know, that's awesome news, but I would just rather be safe than sorry. So I don't mind traveling with bamboo needles. Because I really don't enjoy checking my bag. I just like packing light and just going, you know? So I don't know. I'm fine bringing bamboo needles with me on vacation if it means that I don't have to risk having my knitting taken away from me. So, but yeah, thank you for letting me know. One day I might have to just give it a try and see what happens. Maybe I'll just bring a decoy project with me, you know, on metal needles and see what happens. But just kind of get over that fear. But if you can even call that a fear, but yeah, so just, yeah, that is where I am with this. So any hooser, did I just say any hooser? Apparently I did. Okay, so I'm gonna move along to spinning because I have been doing a little bit of spinning this week. Who am I? I feel like it's been forever and a day since I had a spinning segment on here, but I am doing my best to bring it back because it has been way too long since I've talked about spinning, and I definitely want to get back into it this summer, especially because, you know, I think we are going up to the Cape this summer, and I think drop spindling will definitely be one of those things that I bring with me to work on. But the other night, maybe about a week ago, Dennis and I were grilling out on the deck, and I decided, you know what, it's been a while since I've spun, let's bring out the Golding, because there was already fiber on it at the time, and I was like, you know, let's, you know, it decided to join us for dinner, so I brought it out, and this is my Golding spindle. It has an ebony, this is all ebony right here, if I can get that to focus. And let me see, yeah, there we go. And this is has to be one of my favorite spindles that I own. It's just so well balanced, so well made, and it's one of their smaller sizes. It's not a full size one. It's under an ounce, which is perfect for me. And yes, this is the infamous spindle that fell into a glass of wine on a particular knit night, but it's held up. It's, you know, it still serves me well, and you know, it works perfectly. So again, very well made. But I had a batling of Hobbledehoy. This is a 2 ounce bag of batlings that I purchased from Hobbledehoy, which is an awesome shop. I love, 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 love Hobbledehoy fiber. And yeah, just a whole combination of blues, like mainly purples, some teals. Like, look at that. How awesome is that? And there's this really cool cobalt blue, like pop of blue in there. And you know, I already spun up 3 mini skeins, but you know, this is nothing to write home about or anything, but I did finish spinning 1 batling, so I thought I would share it with you. So here it is. So yeah, just a simple purple with some little pops of blue and stellina in there. And here are the other 2 that I have already spun up. So one's just a darker purple, and one's like this really cool like sage green. And the plan for this is, mainly I'm ripping a page out of Carlene from the Made with Carlenergy podcast. I'm ripping out a page from her book because she does these awesome, she just knits these really gorgeous hand spun shawls, and you know, with batlings mainly, and also those loop bullseye bumps, and she just, because there are so many handspun friendly shawls out there, where you know, it just makes sense. You know, it's like you spin all these really gorgeous little mini skeins and then you knit them all up together to create a really beautiful shawl. And Carlene does a lot of that, so I'm very inspired by it. If you haven't checked out her podcast, do, because she knits a lot of those things and her spinning is really beautiful, and she's a newbie spinner too. So Carlene, you know, you are awesome. And yeah, the plan is to do something similar with this, although it is 2 ounces, I will have to combine it with another 2 ounces of something, which I haven't decided on yet. But you know, my idea is just to spin up a whole bunch of these little mini skeins from batlings or these mini bats and knit a shawl out of it. Because yeah, I don't think I've ever like really officially, I've knit one thing out of hand spun. I have, I can't even remember the pattern name, but I did knit a shawl out of my hand spun. Let me see if I have it. So this is probably the only hand knit item that I've knit out of hand spun. And this is the, oh goodness, it's a pattern by Boston Jen, and she gifted this to me a long time ago. I knit it in Cape Cod, and the fiber is Corgi Hill Farms, and I saw this colorway and I had to get it and spun it up immediately as soon as it arrived. But I get a lot of use out of this, and it's spun up as kind of like a worsted to bulky weight yarn. So the pattern was perfect, and I'm again blanking on the name of it. Yeah, but I'll put it in the down bar because I don't have it in front of me. And I actually soaked it with Tuft Woolens. I have to order more Tuft Woolens, you guys, because her stuff smells amazing, and it still smells. I think I blocked this maybe over a year ago, and it still smells to this day of just yummy citrus something. I forgot what it was, but anyway, it's just really lovely, and yeah, I definitely get a lot of use out of it. So I'm gonna take this off immediately because it is super hot out right now. I'm actually sweating, but I don't want to turn the air conditioner on right now because I'm recording. But anyway, love this pattern, love the fiber, and yeah, so I definitely want to knit something else out of my hand spun soonly. So I think that will be my spinning project for the summer. Just spin up a whole bunch of little mini batlings and make something with it. So, but yeah, otherwise, speaking of more spinning, yeah, there is more spinning. And this is my shelf, by the way. I know I'm jumping tangents, but anyway, that is my shelf, which has all my hand knit shawls and mainly shawls. They're all there. But while Lara was here, she had brought her Turkish spindle that I gifted to her for Christmas, and she wanted me to show her how to use it. So of course we sat out on my deck and we just spun a little bit, and I showed her, you know, how to do the Turkish spindle. And I showed it off on the last episode, but I haven't made much progress on it at all, except, you know, I did spin on it a little bit yesterday. But here it is. And this is a glow-in-the-dark spindle that I got from Turtle Maid, which is a 3D printed Turkish spindle. And again, her spindles are incredibly well made. You know, and they're very well balanced, and they're even 3D printed. It glows in the dark, which is awesome. Yeah, and I'm just spinning a little fibery tribble from Gourmet Stash in this really cool seaweed green colorway. And it was just like a sample fiber bump. So, and yeah, I have a whole lot more to go through, but yeah, just a little mini bump that I will probably include with my little shawl project that I just established that I'm going to be working on this summer. So yay for spinning, it's back in my life, I think, I hope. So, but that said, I am gonna move right along into stash enhancements. And I feel like it's been a while since I have purchased yarn, but while Laura was here, I had organized a knit night at Brooklyn General, which we had so much fun. So many people showed up. I was so surprised. And we actually shut the place down. I even said it while we were there. I'm like, we're gonna shut this place down because, yeah. We arrived at 5 o'clock, and I think we had 2 more hours before Brooklyn General had to close. But the, you know, the shop people were just very cool. I think the owner was there, and you know, they were just like so happy that we were just hanging out, having a good time. They let us take our time, you know, to wrap things up. But of course, I had to buy something because when you go to a yarn shop, it's really hard for me not to come away with anything. And one thing I will say about Brooklyn General, in the past, like I've known that, you know, Brooklyn General is good I know I can go to Brooklyn General for Madeline Tosh, for Malabrigo, for Rowan, for Jameson Spindrift, you know, but when I went there last time, they had a lot more in stock. They had some new brands, new to me brands. They had brands that they never had, that they never carried before. And I was just really excited about that. And one brand that stood out to me, well, first I saw the colorway and I was like, all right, I can't not leave without this because it just really called out to me. And this is by Road to China, and I've never knit with this brand before. I've heard of it, but yeah, I've never experienced it. And let me see if I can get that to focus. No camera, focus on the yarn. There we go. And how cool is that? It's just like this very slate gray, but it has this really awesome pink halo to it, which I absolutely love. And it's, I'm not sure if it's a sport, I believe it's like a fingering to sport weight. It doesn't really say on the label, but again, it's wrote to, I apologize, there's a motorcycle outside my house doing wheelies, apparently. Again, Bushwick is incredibly loud. But yeah, it's Road to China Light in the Ametrine colorway. It's 65% baby alpaca, 10% cashmere, 10% camel, and 15% silk. So it is quite yummy. Yeah, I spent the whole time like petting it, wanting to, yeah, anyway, you get the idea. But it's only 50 grams, you get 159 yards per skein. So of course, I had to get two. And then it only made sense to get a matching or contrasting colorway because in my mind I was like, this is gonna be a shawl, but I want it to be like multicolored. So I got this really cool like slate gray to go with it. And here's the tag so you can see, there we go. And yeah, same base, except it's the hematite colorway. Really, really lovely. And the price point, I got four. it had to be done. Let me see, there we go. And the price point, I will say, is quite attractive. I think it's $16 US per skein, so very happy about that. So it made sense for me to get four skeins, you might as well. So yeah, that's what I came away with. Very happy about that. And then Michael Dvorjan, who is a designer, if you haven't heard of him, he has a lot of patterns in Vogue knitting, and he also has the Penguin Coffee Clatch podcast. Sorry, my nose is very itchy. But he was there with his wife Tanya. Hi guys! It was really good to see them, but he was working on a new design, and he really awesomely gifted Laura and I some mini skeins from the project he was working on. And you guys, look how cute that is! They're so floofy! It's, let me see, it's, I believe the yarn is called Dale Erie, and it's 56% mohair, 20% silk, and 18% wool. And here's his card for his podcast, in case you guys are curious, because Michael is awesome. There we go. So, yeah, and thank you so much, Michael. These are awesome. I think I will just pet these for a while before, I don't know what I'm gonna make with these. These are almost too fluffy to knit into a memory blanket. What am I going to make with them? There's gotta be something I can make with them. Anyway, but, or just knit them into my memory blanket. They'll just be two extra floofy squares. we'll find a project for them. But anyway, that was what I came away with. That was my Brooklyn General haul. But while Laura was here, she had brought along some yarn for me from her shop. And my jaw actually dropped because while I was watching her last podcast, when she showed this off, it's so much more beautiful in person. But this is her colorway, Magic Show. And it's so like opalescent, I wanna say. But yeah, here's her logo. And this is her single merino base, Magic Show colorway, which is 100% superwash merino, 400 yards. And I really love it. I really don't know what I'm gonna make with it, but it will marinate in my stash, and I can just look at it and admire it because it's so pretty. Thank you, Laura. So yeah, and I'm trying to think what else. Laura and I actually stopped off at, when we were bumming around Brooklyn, there's an art shop. I think Jacqueline from the Brooklyn Knit Folk podcast talks about this place all the time, and I used to go there when I first moved to Brooklyn. But since we were in the neighborhood, we were walking by, we actually stopped in, and this art store has actually expanded and has become way more awesome since I remember I last visited it. But I have kind of been like toying with the idea of getting back into drawing and sketching. Because before I found knitting, I was very into that stuff, like sketching, oil painting was a big thing for me. And yeah, then I found knitting and then the rest is history. So, but you know, recently I've just been kind of getting like the itch to, you know, draw a little bit more. I actually miss it, you know, like doodling and all that fun stuff. So I did pick up some, sketching pencils, just some, you know, basics, Staedtler. I have random pencils like these floating around my apartment, but, or my house. But I just got like a new set, you know, just to kind of like say, you know, hey, let's do this again. So if that makes any sense. So I got these, I don't know if you can see that. Yeah. So I got some of these. They're just about maybe six different shades of graphite in here, and a kind of sharpener I like to do. I definitely have a lot of sketchbooks lying around, so you know, I didn't have to invest in a new one. So I'm, you know, looking forward to having a little fun with that. Maybe I'll do a little sketching this summer. And then I also purchased this card. I don't know if you can see it. It's a unicorn and it says, "Your magic." Yeah. Could not leave without that. So yeah, that was a lot of fun, visiting my old stomping grounds in Williamsburg and getting to visit, you know, some shops that I like to frequent and everything. But yeah, otherwise, I think I'm gonna segue into sewing because I do have some new fabric that I had purchased. Some new fabric came in the mail that I had purchased this week. So very excited to share those with you. I don't have any new sewing to share with you this week. The horror, I know, who am I again? But yeah, as I said, I ordered new fabric, which I have plenty of plans for. If you recall, I had purloined a segment from Katie of the Inside Number 23 podcast. She has a segment called Netflix and Knit and Sew. Which is where she is inspired by either knitwear or an outfit from a movie and then tries to recreate them for herself. And I love that idea because I'm always seeing, you know, items in, you know, garments in, you know, the same thing. Like I always want to recreate certain outfits from movies, hence what I'm wearing right now, which is the Anna dress, a dress inspired by, or fabric that is inspired by a dress that Mia Wartzikova wore in Jane Eyre. Obviously hers was more Victorian and historical, and mine is more, the shape of it, construction is more modern and up to date, but the fabric is definitely very similar to what her character wore in the film. But I love that concept and I'm always, you know, inspired by, you know, different outfits and everything. But as you know, I had been planning to make a dress inspired by Keira Knightley's character in Begin Again. She had this very vintagey button-down shirt dress that was red plaid. So my goal, I bought the pattern and everything and I got the fabric. Let me get the fabric really quick. So this is the fabric I had purchased to make the dress I saw from Begin Again, and it looked a little different online, but in person, I'm not too crazy about it. I don't think it's really for me. I could probably make it work, but really it doesn't call out to me. It doesn't scream my name or anything. So I think what I'm going to do with this is actually make a shirt for Dennis. And McCall's had been having a sale. I think their patterns were like $3.99 or $5.99 US at the time. So I just decided, you know what, Dennis could use a summer shirt. So, and I've never sewn a summer shirt, or I've never sewn a shirt for a man before. So I'm very excited to kind of, you know, dip my toes in that area as far as sewing is concerned. So I purchased this pattern. It's nothing fancy, just a basic men's button-down shirt. And I'm probably gonna go with this version since it's summer. And this is McCall's M6044. This version of it with the, you know, the gingham totally reminds me, I don't know if you're familiar, but on Instagram, there's this one Instagram feed where I believe it's called That Gingham J. Crew Shirt, because apparently J. Crew makes this a very similar gingham shirt that everyone apparently has. So there's this, you know, people going around photographing people in this shirt because everyone has it and posting it to Instagram. So this shirt kind of reminded me of that and gave me a chuckle. So anyway, I'm totally digressing. Look it up if you're curious. But digressing. So I'm gonna try and make a shirt for Dennis and see how that goes. Yeah, so since my Begin Again dress is kind of on the back burner for now, I have also been inspired by another outfit that I've seen on a series recently, or for quite some time. And believe me, stick with me, this is gonna sound a lot crazier than it really is, but Game of Thrones. Okay, yeah, just bear with me, it's not as crazy as it sounds, but Cersei. As you know, I am a huge fan of Cersei. I love the dresses that she wears. They're all like wrap dresses, kimonos, and like the flowing sleeves. Need I say more? And I actually did go with Cersei for Halloween one year, and I made the dress, I sewed the pattern from Simplicity, and it was awesome. I loved it. But there's this one dress that she wears. It's of course mauve, and it has like a contrasting, it's like a wrap dress, but it also has like a contrasting gold neckline. Really beautiful, and of course there's like embroidery everywhere. But I thought, how cool would it be just to create like a modern day version of this dress? Sans sleeves, you know, flowing sleeves, but you know, just a modern day version wrap dress using the same color scheme, if you will. So I, of course, while I was, well, in addition to getting the shirt that I'm gonna, the shirt pattern that I got for Dennis, I also purchased this one, and I figured I'll try and post a photo of the dress that I'm talking about Cersei's. But then I also found this dress, which is McCall's M6959. So here it is. So you see where I'm going with this. Basically, I'm going to be making this version, like this top version, maybe like a quarter inch sleeve, and then, where is it? Hello? This bottom, so like a flared, you know, obviously A-line skirt version with just a quarter inch sleeves. And then maybe making, because right now this is bias tape right here, I might substitute that with a thicker neckline. But I think when it comes to the fabric, I think I nailed it. And I found this fabric on fabric.com. I'm not entirely sure what the make is. I think it's, oh goodness, Henry Miller. I could be totally wrong. I'll put it in the down bar, but I definitely nailed it. So here's going to, this is the main fabric that I'm going to be using for the main body, main part of the dress. So it's this really awesome mauve chambray fabric, which is like a very lightweight cotton. So that's going to be like the main part. And then for the contrasting neckline, I'm going to be using this, which is like this gold camel color. So if you can imagine, it's going to be like one way this way and one way that way, maybe a little thinner, not as thick, but you get where I'm going, right? So you're probably thinking, well, what about the long flowing sleeves? I'm going to be leaving that part out only because I don't want to get eyes when I go grocery shopping or walking down the street. That might be a little much, although I was contemplating making sleeves that are attachable for those days when I'm feeling extra fancy, but that's still TBD. But anyway, I did, while I was on fabric.com, I also did purchase some more fabric, like you do. And I will show this to you right now. I got this really fun fabric. It had a very Art Nouveau feel, which is an art style that I absolutely love. And I think Nina from the This Old Knit podcast, which is an awesome podcast you should also check out, can agree with me because she also loves Art Nouveau. So Nina, I think you would like this too. I don't know, just saying. And I have no idea what it's going to be. I just really love the fabric. They kind of look like owl eyes, but I think it's, I might make another Hollyburn skirt, which was the last thing that I sewed. Was that mustard colored skirt that I posted about it on Instagram. I love that skirt. It's been getting a lot of use, and again, one of my favorite patterns to actually sew. So I think this might have to be another Hollyburn, but we'll see. And then this other fabric that I got, this has been kind of sitting in my cart on fabric.com. You know, it was like, yeah, no. And then finally I just decided to pull the trigger because if it's doing that to me, it might as well just be in my life. And I'm not sure how to describe this fabric, but let me see. It's Kashibo Abstract Floral. I'm not really sure what the fabric, it's like a nylon, almost like a lawn, but it had like a silky lawn texture to it. I don't know, but it has these really cool like abstract orchids on it. And it is quite busy. It is a busy pattern, but I think it would make an awesome wrap dress. I don't know. So I have no plans for these fabrics, but I found them very pretty and inspiring. So they had to be in my stash, so I purchased them. And then I also ordered, because I do want to make the, I know I'm dipping, I'm trying not to dip down too much, but I'm also trying to make the sundress from Gertie's new book, her ultimate dress book. There's an eyelet sundress that she has in there. It's just like a simple A-line skirt with, it looks strapless at the top, but then you have two bands. It's like a halter basically. And this is going to definitely be a challenge because it requires boning, horsehair, horsehair braid to, you know, stabilize the top and everything and make it very structurally sound, if you will. And I didn't have the appropriate lining. She did call for broadcloth, and I've never used broadcloth before, so I just ordered, I have the eyelet fabric, but I definitely needed the lining, so I ordered some broadcloth in black, and I can see why she uses it. It's very, it's not the softest fabric you will ever feel. It's quite stiff, but again, it's a very structured dress, so I think this will, you know, be very appropriate for making the dress hold up, especially since I have nothing to help hold the dress up other than boning and structure. So anyway, I'm totally rambling right now. But the other fabric that I purchased, I actually purchased this from fabricworm.com. They had 2 yards left over, and I've been lusting over this fabric for quite some time. A lot of you have already sewn with it, especially KT from number 23, and it was staring me in the face, 2 yards left. I already had the camel color in my cart. I'm like, you know what? I might as well just do it. So I pulled the trigger and got me some yarny fabric. I have, again, no idea what I'm going to make with it. Maybe another Hollyburn skirt. I might as well have 3 in my wardrobe, but every knitter must have some yarny fabric. It had to be done. So, and this is by Cotton and Steel, by the way. So very happy about that. And yeah, otherwise, I think that is it for sewing. And the other thing that I wanted to talk about is the What's a Sloper, hashtag What's a Sloper, which is a thing that I'm doing with Gigi from the Knitmore Girls. We are both making slopers, which is a sloper and a moulage, which are patterns that you draft for yourself that measure out perfectly to your measurements, and you use those to make commercial patterns fit you more appropriately. So it makes sewing a lot easier and takes all the guesswork out of, you know, figuring out what size is yours, because you already have a map, you know, drawn out for yourself. So you just apply that to whatever commercial pattern you're sewing, and apparently it's a piece of cake. Granted, Gigi is light years ahead of me. I still have yet to take my measurements, which is ridiculous. This month has just been crazy, but I think this weekend, I'm going to recruit Dennis to take my measurements and just get the ball rolling on this, because it's crazy that I have not already taken my measurements already. But check out Gigi's progress. She's Gigi Darling on Instagram. Check her out on Ravelry and the Knitmore Girls, because, you know, they've been around for quite some time podcasting, and very excited to be doing this with Gigi, although I'm far behind. But yeah, it's been awesome following her progress. But if you haven't started yet, you know, want to join along and making a sloper with me, please feel free to do that. Hop on over to the Yarngasm Ravelry thread. We have a thread for What's a Sloper. And yeah, let's do this. Come on. I definitely have to say that to myself, because no progress is being made on my part, and I'm sorry, Gigi, if you're watching this. But yeah, I'm definitely gonna get a start on it this weekend. Okay, so I'm gonna move along to Ask Away, which is a segment where you get to ask me pretty much anything you want relating to the podcast, knitting, spinning, hand-dyeing yarn, my life within reason. And this week we have two questions, and the first one is from, looking at my show notes, let me see it, okay. From Chetwer on Ravelry, and she says, "Hi Kristen, wondering if you have a favorite sweater pattern. I'm looking for a cardigan pattern that is top down and isn't too open in the front. I consider the featherweight cardigan, but I would have to add to the fronts as it sits fairly open. I have 1200 yards of your beautiful Outlander yarn colorway and would love to make a sweater." So I totally know what you mean. The featherweight cardigan by Hannah Fettig sits fairly open, so it's a very open cardigan. You can't really smush up with it or anything like that. But I will say that I love that pattern. It's lovely. It's been getting a lot of use over the winter and fall. I will say, like, fall, winter, and spring, it has gotten a lot of use. But I definitely know what you mean. And I did a little research, and I stumbled upon the Georgetown cardigan, another pattern by Hannah Fettig, which is very similar to the featherweight, but it does, the collar does sit a little closer. It's a wider collar, wraps around more closely, but yeah, it's plain stockinette, and definitely check that one out. There's also the Abigail Cardi by Cecily Glowick McDonald, which, again, very similar. I think it has a quarter inch sleeve. I'm not entirely sure, but I'm pretty sure it does have a quarter inch sleeve. But it has one of those longer fronts and a shorter back, kind of like a reverse mullet, if you will. But yeah, very simple cardigan and definitely closes a lot closer in the front. So check that one out. And another pattern that I wanted to mention was the Pomme de Pin cardigan. Which is a cardigan that I have knit, and a really beautiful, albeit little challenging pattern if you love knitting lace. And even though it is lace, it is a very cozy sweater. It's a long cardigan, it closes in the front, it has like a rolled up collar that you can just smush around you. And that, you know, it's right now it's in, obviously it's summer, but it did not make an appearance this past winter, which is a shame because I definitely have to take it out, give it a nice wash or soak, and then reblock it, and then bring it back into circulation because it is one of my favorite cardigans and patterns. So do check that out. Although I do believe it calls for sport weight yarn, I think you can get away with fingering weight. Just check your gauge and you should be good. But yeah, definitely check those out. I will link to these patterns in the show notes, which you can find at yarngasmpodcast.com. I totally forgot to mention that in the beginning of the episode, but that's where you can find all the show notes. So I hope that answers your question or helps. And then our next question is from Mickey Nutt. And she says, "Hello, Kristen. I have been dyeing yarn for a little while now, and I am wondering what you use to dye your yarn. For example, I have been using a stainless steel round stock pot to dye in, but I'm wondering if I could do better with a shallower stainless roasting pan. I'm mostly trying to get the effects of speckling and multiple colors. Thanks so much. Love your podcast, and you have inspired me to start sewing also, but mostly bags and a bit of quilting." Yay! I'm so glad you're sewing again. And yeah, that's so exciting to hear. So very glad about that. But yes, I think I mentioned on another podcast, I do have a range of pot sizes that I use for dyeing yarn. I have stock pots, and then I also have shallower pots. There is no right or wrong pot to use. As long as it's stainless steel, you're gold. So you gotta, you know, find a style that you like and stick with it, or, you know, experiment. But yeah, I definitely recommend using a shallower pot for creating speckles. You can even use a regular stock pot, just don't fill it up all the way. Like, maybe I would say fill it up one quarter of the actual height of the pot and lay your yarn in there and use that to speckle. But yes, I do recommend shallow water to fill your pot up shallow, to a shallow height. And, you know, so maybe your skeins aren't totally submerged, or just a little, you know, very close to the top of the water. And that will totally help you create the speckle effect that you're looking for, multiple colors. Because when you have the yarn too far from the surface of the water, that gives the dye, when it goes in, more of a chance to bleed and spread and everything. But if it doesn't, if the dye doesn't have far to fall onto the yarn, you're more likely to get that speckled or multicolored effect that you're looking for. So I hope that helps. And yeah, if you have any questions, please feel free to leave them in the Ask Away thread in the Yarngasm Ravelry group, and I will do my best to answer them here on the podcast or they're right there in the thread, depending how time sensitive they are. So yeah, thank you so much for your questions. That said, I'm gonna move along to shop update and let me go get my yarn. Okay, so first I just want to say thank you to everybody who made the shop update last night. Last night all of the skeins that I dyed with Laura went up for sale on my shop, and they sold out like hotcakes, you guys. Thank you so much. I was not anticipating them going that fast. But I'm so glad that you were excited, and I hope you enjoy, for those of you who were able to snag some skeins, I hope you enjoy the yarn as much as Laura and I enjoyed dyeing them. We had so much fun together, and definitely plan on doing another collaboration in the near future, so stay tuned for that. Probably not for another year, but we'll see what happens. But you know, in case you missed out, I just wanted to show you what we did dye together. And this skein actually went live in Laura's shop on Wednesday, and those have been spoken for. They have all sold out, but this is, so you know, you can see what we dyed together. This is the colorway that she sold in her shop. We both dyed these together, like both these skeins we dyed together. We just took turns adding layers until we were happy with the results, and we were very happy with the results. And this is, she called this one Menahan, after the street that I live on in Bushwick. And yeah, I think, you know, it's very appropriate because there's a lot of graffiti in Brooklyn, or Bushwick I should say, a lot of graffiti murals, and it's very colorful, so definitely a good name for it. And I kept a skein on her glitter base. She has her glitter, her glitz base has silver stellina in it, so I kept this one for myself. And here are the two skeins that, well, we both dyed them across two bases. So we had a single space and then we also had a stellina base. So this is the one that I'm keeping, the one that I sold in my shop yesterday. And I called this one Bushwick Nights. I'm just trying to get this to focus because my camera wants to focus on my face. There we go. And I call this one Bushwick Nights. And yeah, I'm just so happy with the way this turned out. Really pretty. And then here's what it looked like on my blitz base. Let me see if I can get that to focus. There we go. So yeah, lots of fun. Just thank you again to everybody who was able to snag some skeins, and I, you know, hope you enjoy the yarn that's coming your way. But yes, I will be having an international friendly shop update tomorrow, which is Saturday, June 25th at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. But just to clarify, international shop updates, I sell internationally all the time for every update. So even, you know, I have been getting some comments about that. Yes, what, you know, even though it's not an international shop update, if you live internationally, if you don't live in the US, I still sell internationally. I just kind of switch the time and dates around to accommodate those who aren't always able to make the Friday 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time time slot. So yeah, the last Saturday of every month, I always do an international friendly update, just FYI, and that will be tomorrow. So let me give you a little preview of what's gonna be in the shop. I have my basket of yarns, and this is a colorway that I have not dyed for a while, and I thought it was time to bring it back into circulation. But this is Reflector, a colorway inspired by one of my favorite bands, Arcade Fire. They have an album cover with like a lot of these similar colors, and I thought, you know, it was one of the first colorways I've ever dyed, and thought that, you know, yeah, the album cover has to be a colorway. So this is what I came up with, and this will be available in the shop. Here it is on, let me see. This is it on my blitzed base, Gold Stellina, and here it is on Volca. I'll also have it on Footsie. Okay, and then I will also have some succulents. Let's see. Go. So very tonal, like light mint green. It just reminds me of like the succulent plants. And then I will also have some Beach Bum, which is a very popular colorway. I'll just show it to you one at a time. Here it is on Footsie. And I will have these dyed across several of my bases. So this is just an example of, you know, what I have now. Yeah, and then here it is on Blitzed. And then I will also have some Gashly Crumb. It's been a while since I dyed this one as well, so time to bring it back out. Yeah, here it is. And this is inspired by Edward Gorey. It was not part of the Yarn Club, but this is the first Edward Gorey inspired colorway that I dyed up. And I just, yeah, just a really fun colorway. And then I will have some Venus Flytrap. So there's that. And then, of course, I will have some Fairy Hair. And here it is on Volca and my Blitz base. As far as pairings go, I've been getting a lot of requests to show off some colorways that I think go together in case you want to do a main color or a contrasting color for a particular project. But yeah, I definitely recommend... I definitely recommend Gashly Crumb and Venus Flytrap. I think those go really well together. I also think that these two guys go together, Beach Bum and Succulents. Really nice summery combination. Even if you wanted to, you could do Venus Flytrap and Succulents. I think those go very well together. And I know Nina from This Old Knit podcast, she is knitting a Penny Candy top and using these two colorways together. And I think these go really, really well together, Fairy Hair and Succulents. So yeah. And then of course, Succulents and Reflector. I think these go really well together too. Yeah, so I'm trying to think what else. Yeah, I feel like Succulents is a very versatile colorway. And then even if you wanted to, you could do, if you love that pink orange combination, you know? So, and yeah, those are my recommendations. But yeah, I hope you can make the update tomorrow. Again, Saturday, June 25th at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. So yeah, that said, I think I'm going to move on to Blather. Okay, so Blather, the segment where I get to talk about what's been going on in my life. And a lot has been going on. I really don't know where to start, but I guess I'll start from the very beginning. Laura showed up last Thursday. I cannot believe it's already a whole week, already Friday since she showed up. But anyway, she showed up last Thursday and then left Monday, but we did so much together. Again, as I mentioned, the point of her trip was to surprise her friend Maria for her baby shower, but we also decided that it was a great opportunity for us to collaborate on yarn dyeing again. So we did that. We dyed, I think, a total of 20 skeins. We dyed a total of 40 skeins. So I sold 20 in my shop, she sold 20 in her shop. Thank you again to everybody who made the update. And yeah, in the meantime, I just took her around Brooklyn, showed her the sights, took her to some vegan places, and I always it's always interesting, you know, because Laura's a vegan, and I am by no means a vegan. I'm probably the most carnivorous person I know, which I know some of you vegetarians and vegans out there, I'm sorry. But yeah, I do appreciate really good vegetarian and vegan food occasionally. And it was really fun getting to try some new places that are in our neighborhood that I definitely want to go back to with Dennis. We tried this Ethiopian place, which was very good. We went to, it was Buna Cafe. And then after Brooklyn General, we tried this place called Mazat, which we had actually gone to, not Laura and I, but some knitting friends after a Brooklyn General meetup, which is very good. And then I also took Laura to this place, Whiskers, which is in my neighborhood. It's more like a bakery breakfast type of place, but they have really good scones. I had some vegan yogurt and granola for the first time, and I actually really like vegan yogurt. It has kind of like a fluffy, whipped creamy kind of taste, so I definitely will be going back there. Plus, the place is adorable. But anyway, I won't go on too much about, you know, everything we did or anything, but if you do want to find out more about what we did and follow our adventures and everything, Laura did post a vlog about everything on her podcast, which is The Dyer's Notebook, so do check that out. But yeah, as I mentioned, Maria was completely surprised, and more of our knitting friends were there, so that was great. We got to hang out with them. And then, yeah, it was a really good, fun time, so I cannot wait to do it again. And yeah, like I said, I really miss having a live-in knitting friend, which is really fun. But anyway, other than that, oh, and I forgot to mention, there was one day where Laura went off with some other friends, you know, for the day, and then Dennis and I pretty much spent the whole day. You know, we decided every year we do this trail. It's out in close by Rockaway. It's called the Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge, and we pretty much do it every year. They have trails that go in and around. You know, you don't feel like you're in the city at all, although in the distance you can see Rockaway, you can see the city and everything, but it's a nice escape, you know. So we do the walk, and we decided to go back there, but this time we went across. There's like a road, and apparently across the road there's an extension of the trail, or like another part of the refuge that we had never explored. So this time we checked it out, and oh my gosh, it was so pretty. They have these little boxes that you can go into, and they have holes where you can look in and actually see wildlife like hanging out right there really close up. We saw swans, and you know, we took a lot of photos. I'll try and put some of that at the end of the episode for you to check out. But and then after that, we headed on over to Rockaway Beach, which has done a total 180. They totally renovated it. If you're not familiar, Hurricane Sandy really had an effect there. You know, there was so much damage, and we had been there last year, but this year I don't know what happened, but they just rehauled the entire boardwalk. Everything was brand new. There was actually a surf competition happening, and yeah, we just bummed around the boardwalk, and then we grabbed some food, and you know, then later on Dennis had a show. Laura and I met up, you know, Dennis had to do sound check and everything, and then Laura and I just met up with him there, and yeah, we just had a really fun day, you know. But yeah, otherwise, this weekend we're gonna just lay low, take it easy. I think, you know, spend a little bit of time together, because last weekend you know, Dennis had his own things going on too, so we didn't really get to spend too much time together. So yeah, I think, you know, we'll just kind of take it easy this weekend, relax. I'm gonna try and get some sewing done. So otherwise, I think that is it for this week. So without further ado, happy knitting, everybody, and I will see you next time. Bye.